Good night, everyone. My name is Luis Cardoso, and I'm working as a front-end developer at Fitzroy. I'm here to talk about React best practices. So let's get cracking, because we have a lot to cover. First, I want to just ask a raise of hands who already worked with React. Okay, great. Because I'm kind of assuming that you already know at least a little bit of React. So I'm going first to talk about how the rendering model of React works. So because it's important to understand certain good practices. React is based off the concept of Virtual DOM. Virtual DOM is a programming concept of basically having an ideal representation of your UI in memory and then syncing that ideal representation to the DOM. And this process of syncing the ideal representation and the actual DOM is called reconciliation. Having this separation enables React to have a declarative API. And you can basically just tell React what you want the state of UI to be, and React will do all the manipulation of the DOM attributes, DOM elements, and so forth for you using a library like React DOM. But how does this work in practice in React? Well, imagine that you have element tree like this. You have basically a user list. This will be rendered in the DOM like this. So just a simple list of users. Now, the magic happens when you try to change something. For example, if I change the name of the second user, React will produce a second state tree. And to know what we need to change in the DOM, we need to compute the difference between the two trees. So this is what is called the reconciliation. And to do this, we start by checking we check all elements in both trees and compare them. And this comparison is done first by seeing if the element of the tree is a React component. In that case, we check if the instance is the same. If it's not the same, we need to re-render the whole tree, subtree, because that's a different instance, we may have different things. If it's the same instance, we proceed for checking the children. If it is, instead of a React component, a DOM element, we check the type. If the type is the same, we check the attributes, and if there are any different attributes, we just update the different attributes as necessary. So in this example, we go through all the elements and we see, oh, the name changed, so I just need to update the name there. This works well for the non-data that is not structured in lists. And in lists also works well, for example, if we are appending elements to the end of the list. In this case, we added a new user then, and if we proceed with the algorithm, we see that, okay, then was added here, so we just add it to the DOM there, so it's easy. However, the problem becomes if you add elements to the start or the middle of the list. If I add them there, when I'm doing the checking, I see these two are different, and these two are different, and I don't know this. So I would render the whole tree. And this is where the key element that I think most of you already know enters, because it allows you to map elements in different trees and know that they are actually the same. So now I have the keys in place. So I know Alice moved to the second position, Bob to the third, and I have a new element here. I just need to add that one. So keys are a big part of making rendering lists in React fast. But what else is there to optimize in terms of performance in the React application? What are the good practices besides using the key element? Well, the main thing is to reduce unnecessary effort. Imagine that you have this state tree. If I just change one attribute, in this case, I just changed the photo URL there. React will compare everything just to find out that the just one attribute changed. So this has a lot of unnecessary work here. What can you do to optimize this? Well, we can see that the first user did not actually change anything. And right from the start, we can see that if the props didn't change, probably the children of the user Alice did not change. So if we can make this assumption, this is what it is called in functional programming, a pure function, or in this case, a pure component, we can optimize by saying if the properties of the user did not change, we do not need to go and check the children. So if we do that, we no longer need to do this check, and we actually don't even need to create the label and image elements in the second tree. And in React, we have already a way of doing this very easily. That is by using pure component, which is a version of the component that you guys probably already know, but that does this check of not rendering if the props are the same. For more complex cases, you can use the shoot component update that where you can programmatically decide if you want to render or not. So, summing up, pure component for stateless components. If you are using functional components, there's also a way of using the same functionality, which is called React Memo, which I'm going to talk about later. And you can use shoot component update for more complex cases. There are, however, some caveats. Because, as I said, pure component only compares the props, and it compares the value of the props. If I pass an object to a pure component, it will compare the reference to the object. It will not compare the properties inside the object. So even if I change the object, if I pass the same object again, the pure component will not know that the object has changed. So I will not get a render as I would like. Another problem that we can see in this image is that if I create an object implicitly when I'm instantiating the component, as I do here, this will always create a new object. So the pure component will always see a new instance, so it will always render. So how can we solve both these problems? Well, it's very easy actually. You just need to pass the properties that we need in the object as top level properties. Just a note here, obviously, if you need to pass like dozens of things, properties, you should not obviously put them as all as top level properties. You should probably have a complex object, and then you should component update to avoid having like this horrible API of having to define lots of props. The same happens with functions. In this case, if I create an anonymous function here, or if I create a new function by calling bind here, this will always be a new object, because functions are objects in JavaScript, and this will also cause a re-render of the pure component. To avoid this, we have several strategies. The most conservative one would be to manually bind the methods in the constructor, but we can also use the class property syntax that is not stable, so it's not actually part of the stable standard, but already pretty advanced, and you can use it with people. In case of the refs, if you actually need to use the refs, there's an API where you can create refs, which is create ref, and you can use it. And how can we detect if our app has unnecessary renders or not? Well, there are two main ways. First, there is the React developer tools, which, is, by the way, is a must-have extension if you develop using React. And it has this highlight update functionality. And it will highlight the parts of your app that are being re-rendered. So as in this case of this image, if I'm writing on an input and my whole app is being re-rendered, even the to-dos that I did not change by writing on the input, well, I can optimize that by not rendering the already written to-dos. There's another way of doing this, that is using the YDD update package, that if you add it to your project, it will log instances of renders that are not actually necessary or may not be necessary. Another problem or possible problem is that if you have huge lists with like thousands of elements, it's not viable to render them all in React even with these optimizations possibly. So what you want to do is virtualize or use a technique called virtualization or windowing that only renders the visible part of the list and some buffers above and below. And this will make sure that your number of nodes is constant even if you have this immense list. There are some libraries for this, because this is obviously a bit tricky to implement. And if you need to profile your application, there are two main ways of doing this. If you want to use your browser native profiling capabilities, one important advice is to disable the Chrome developer extension that it interferes with measurements and even other extensions. Or you can use the React DevTools profiler if you are using React 16.5 or more recent than that. Another big part of React are the lifecycle hooks. And I have to make two notes here. First is that recently the hooks project was announced, which is still in development and is set for launching in React 16.7, but this will probably change dramatically how we program in React. So just be aware of this, but I'm not going to talk about this because these are unstable APIs. And in React 16.3 and 4, there were major changes to the lifecycle API, so be aware of this. I'm talking about the most recent changes, and you should also obviously try to avoid using the methods that were deprecated by those changes if possible. So how is the lifecycle of a React component? We have three main phases. We have mounting, updating, and unmounting. When we are mounting, first thing that is called is the constructor. And here, one very important thing is that you should not introduce any side effects in the constructor, like subscribing to events or things like that. You should only do that in the componented mount or componented update. The constructor must be a pure function. Or not have side effects outside of the component. After that, get derived state from props is called. This is a method that should be used only in the rare cases where you need the state to depend on the values of the props over time. So usually you should not use this method. If you think you should use it, you need to use it, I recommend you to check the React documentation for possibly better ways of doing what you need to do. After that, render is called. Render as the constructor should also be a function without side effects. If you need to interact with the browser, just do it in the componented mount or componented update methods. And finally, the DOM is updated and we call componented mount. When updated, the first thing that we do is call get derived state from props, then should component update. Should component update is the method that I told you that can indicate to React if React should render the component or not. And here there's a very important thing to notice or to be aware of is that this is just an indication. You cannot rely on the behavior or not rendering, because in the future the React may decide to render or not according to some heuristics. So you should not rely on this behavior for your application behavior to work as you expect. So this should only be an optimization, not an application behavior. If should component update returns true, we proceed to render and then to get snapshot before update. This method allows you to read values from the DOM before the DOM is changed. For example, scroll position that you need to save to use later. And then we update the DOM and call componented update. And when unmounting, we just call component unmount. Here, you just have to remember to clean up any side effects that you may have introduced, such as listening to event listeners that are outside of the component or anything like that. Some other considerations. It is advisable to try to use strict mode because it warns you if you are doing some bad practices in terms of lifecycle hooks. Also using the error boundaries is very good because you have rendering. If you don't implement this, you run the risk of parts of your application turning blank. And in the constructor, you should be aware that this .props is only available if you call super.props at the start. And if you are mounting React components manually, don't wait to React DOM. Don't forget to unmount them, because if you don't do that, your component tree may not be cleaned up and you may end up with like zombie components consuming memory in your app. Set state is the method that is used in React to update the state of the component. And one very important thing to be aware of is that set state is asynchronous. And this can have consequences that may not be obvious at first. But for example, with this code, if this function is called before the state, this dot state is actually updated, the value of count will not change. It'll just, if it was 2, it will pass 3 and will not pass to 4 and 5 as we would expect, because the state remains the same. So to get around this, we need to pass the callback parameter and mutate the state there in a safe way. Another problem that may also happen is that if you need to do anything after the set state, after the state is changed, you should be aware that since it's asynchronous, you have to pass also a callback so you can know when the state was updated and you don't need to, and avoid relying on set timeouts and X like that. And we can see here in this example that synchronously the state was not changed, and only in another call stack in the future was the state actually updated. And if you are bumping into this issue a lot in your application, it's probably because you are doing something that is not very idiomatic, because this is not a problem that you should have a lot of times. So performance is very good, but it's also very important to have maintainable code and code that we can evolve easily. And one of the very good things to do is to make your render method as small as possible, and so that it can be used as an entry point to your component, and then you can dive in specific parts. In this example, the render user function was extracted out, and this removed even some code duplication and kept the render method small. It's also nice to have the render method at the end of the file, because you always know where it is. You just go to the end of the file, and it's there. If your component is very simple and does not have any state, consider making it or implementing it as a functional component, which is just a function that returns some React elements. And here you need to have the same consideration as in the React method, not to make this like a huge function that is hard to understand. You should also use React Memo that, as we saw, implements the optimizations that your component does. Another pain point are the inline conditionals in GSX, and we should really strive to avoid something like this for our health's sake. And we should refactor this code. There are several options. So we can either pull the conditions out to the render method, we can put them in a separate method, or we can even move the whole thing to a different component altogether. If you are doing also some kind of class manipulation, you need to join classes, make classes appear or not, depending on a variable, you should use the class names library instead of this, you get this, but it's much nicer and is much easier to understand. Another very important thing are the prop types that are a type definition functionality that is built in React itself, and it allows you to do basic type checking, and it also serves as a documentation of the props that your component receives, which is very good. And the API of the prop types is very complete. As you see here, you can check types of objects inside arrays, and even have custom validations, so it's very complete. Regarding refs, so don't use them, or at least if possible. Refs are usually, or can be used a bit to have this imperative way of working in React, and this is not really the way that React works, which is more of a declarative, has more of a declarative philosophy. For instance, if you see yourself in a dialogue exposing an open and close method and using a ref to call open and close, consider to instead pass is open prop so that you can declaratively toggle the state of the dialogue. And you can see this lifting state up guide in the React documentation that gives some examples about this. There are some situations where you may need to use the refs. For example, for managing focus, text to action, media playback, imperative triggering imperative animations, and integration with third-party libraries. But even if in those cases, if you can, try to avoid them because they are not very good. Another important concept is the concept of higher order components. This is more of a pattern in React than something of that that's in the API of React. And it's basically a function that receives a component and returns another component that's wrapped by a component that we control. In this example that I made based off the React documentation, we have a simple higher-order component that simply subscribes to an event and passes that data down to the component, to the wrapped component. And this makes it easier to reuse this logic in several components that don't need to know about subscribing and unsubscribing. Some considerations. It's not a very good idea to mutate the original component inside the higher order component. You should pass unrelated props through the wrapped component to avoid having to always change the higher order component when you want to pass more props to the inner component. You shouldn't do the wrapping in the render method, otherwise you'll be doing the wrapping all the time. And the static methods and refs are not passed through, so you need to do that yourself. And it's also very good to wrap the display name of the component for easy debugging. Otherwise, you have like anonymous components that you don't know what they are. Another less common pattern is function as shell components. That is basically passing a function instead of passing a React element to the children of a React component. So I can use it like this, and this gives me the flexibility of rendering the children any way I want according to the arguments that are passed. This has some overlap with higher order components. The one advantage is that they do not pollute the props space and they not introduce another component in the component hierarchy, but on the other hand, they cannot be optimized with pure component or shoot component update, so it's more of a trade-off. Finally, code splitting. I'm talking about code splitting because some new APIs were introduced in React to improve this, but just to explain what code splitting is, the idea is very simple. Instead, this is not, this does not have enough contrast because there's a rectangle here that you cannot see, but just try to imagine a big rectangle. And imagine that I have this huge app file. I can, to avoid sending this huge file every time to my users with lots of functionalities that the user may not need right away or may not never use, I can split these into several files. So imagine some little rectangles over there. And for example, the main page is something that probably most users will never need to access. So why am I sending it to all users? And when serving the app to the user, I can just send the smaller bundle. So imagine that the rectangle now ends here instead of ending there. And when the user clicks some functionality that he needs to access, I can just load that smaller bundle on demand. So how can I do this? Well, we have already an API to dynamically load modules. This is not part of the standard, but it's implemented by Webpack. And with some configuration, you can make it so that when you import something dynamically, Webpack, for example, will automatically split your app and create a bundle just for that. And React in the 16.6 added some new APIs to make this even easier. So you have React Lazy that wraps an import and automatically creates a component that will only render the component that you are importing when that component loaded. So it makes it easier to show a component that is loaded dynamically. And you have suspense and the its fallback attribute that allows you to just basically show a loading screen when you are still loading the component. And this is bundled in React, so you don't need to use any third-party library. Just one final note. These two APIs, React Lazy and Suspense, are not available yet for server-side rendering. So you should take that into account. And that's it. Thank you.